The way we discussed the theory behind the rank 2 approximation was completely general. We didn't really put a restriction on the number of columns in our matrix A. What that means is that we can now look at what happens as we choose more and more columns for our matrix A. This is what happens if you pick only one column for your matrix A, namely the first column in the picture. Obviously, it's not a very good approximation, but the positive part is that you only need to store one column for A, so that's a vector of size m, and one column for matrix Y, which is one vector of size n, while storing the entire picture required m times n values to be stored. If we move on and we use two columns, we get this. Again, not a particularly good approximation, but it does have the advantage that we only need to store two columns for A and two columns for Y. Go on to five columns for each of them, and you get this, and you can start recognizing the picture. 10 columns for each of them, and you definitely can see the building. Now, you're only storing 10 columns for each, which is a considerable compression relative to matrix B. 25 columns for each, 50 columns for each, and obviously you can use all columns for the approximation. Now, that's all very nice. You get a very good approximation. But now all of a sudden, you're storing more than the original picture if you don't watch out. Here's a homework problem. We kept talking about a rank 1 approximation, a rank 2 approximation, and eventually a rank k approximation where k was some integer. What I want you to do is to prove that a matrix of the form U times V transpose, where U has k columns and V has k columns, has rank at most k. So go ahead and do that homework, and I'll meet you in the next video.